tiroteos se comenzaron a las 12 de la noche.
The shooting began at midnight, and everyone ran toward their homes. People started hollering. Children began crying.
It was a complex operation. 27 targets were hit simultaneously.
I heard my family, some of my family get shot, and I don't know nothing else has happened. I just was keep going because I was frightened to die. I was frightened to die.
The goal was not to level the place, but to minimize damage to property, and most important of all, to minimize casualties, and that was accomplished.
My daughter did not belong to any group. She had nothing to do with Noriega. She was innocent. She had nothing to do with all of this, and they killed her.
If I had to do it again, I would do it again, because the cost was high. It was men, women, civilians, and military that gave their lives, not for us. They gave their lives for democracy, for liberty, for freedom. And I don't mind paying any price under the sun to be free.
Hoy rumba. Sabrosa. Ay, mamita, mami.
Mami, esto sí es verdad, que yo quiero bailar contigo esta Navidad.
Yo me voy con Luis Ramírez a comer lechón, y después sigue el vacilón en casa de Don Ramón. Ay, mamita, mami.
Mami, esto sí es verdad,
lo sabes tú, mami.
Yo quiero bailar contigo esta Navidad.
Y mamita, mami. Sonando el tambor y yo vengo a cantar sabrosa mi bomba. ¿Qué va?
Mami, esto sí es verdad, que yo quiero bailar contigo esta Navidad. Mami, esto sí es verdad.
Mamita, mami.
Que yo quiero bailar contigo.
On December 19, 1989, while Panamanians were getting ready for the Christmas holidays, the United States was secretly mobilizing 26,000 troops for a midnight attack.
Helicopters approaching. They were close. The lights went out and the helicopters began to shoot.
People were running left and right without direction, without knowing where they were going. It wasn't just machine gun fire. They were bombs. The noise was frightening.
You could hear gunfire coming from all directions and a strange noise that we had never heard before. People were frightened, running, wondering what was going on. The sky was completely red and there was a tremor you could feel throughout the city.
The invasion was swift, intense, and merciless. When it was over, Thousands lay dead and wounded, and the country was in shambles. Millions of U.S. tax dollars were swallowed up in 3 days of brutal violence. The strategy was considered a stunning military and political success.
The operation continues.
In many ways, the invasion served as a testing ground for the Persian Gulf War 1 year later. It is also an indication of the kinds of intervention the United States may undertake in the years to come. But still, big questions remain. What exactly happened during the invasion of Panama? And why?
This is the CBS Evening News. Dan Rather reporting. Good evening. More than 20,000 U.S. soldiers and Marines launched their attack in the early morning darkness, backed by swarms of helicopters.
As the invasion unfolded, Americans stayed glued to their TVs and newspapers for coverage. But how much of the real picture did the media give them?
The performance of the mainstream news media in the coverage of Panama has been just about total collaboration with the administration. Not a critical murmur, not a critical perspective, not a second thought.
The story that the White House was pushing was getting this so-called narco-terrorist in a net. And that was the thrust of all of the coverage. When are we going to get Noriega? Have they let Noriega get away?
By late today, they had taken control of much of the country, but their chief target, General Manuel Noriega, escaped.
Manuel Noriega belongs to that special fraternity of international villains, men like Gaddafi, Idi Amin, and the Ayatollah Khomeini, whom Americans just love to hate.
Tonight, the White House announced a $1 million reward for his capture.
And today, the Justice Department set up a hotline to take in tips on Noriega's possible whereabouts. That hotline number is...
They focused on Noriega to the exclusion of what was happening to the Panamanian people, to the exclusion of the bodies in the street, to the exclusion of the number dead, to the exclusion of what happened to the women and children in that country during this midnight invasion.
In some ways, the 1989 U.S. invasion of Panama was no surprise, given the history of relations between these two countries. The United States refused to recognize Panama's independence movement throughout the 1800s. But when the U.S. proposal to build a canal across the isthmus was turned down by Colombia, U.S. policy abruptly changed. In 1903, the United States provided military backup, enabling Panama to secede from Colombia. By doing so, the United States secured the rights to take over the canal project that had been abandoned by the French. In a treaty that was negotiated between the French canal investors and the United States, the Americans were granted sovereign control in perpetuity of a 10-mile-wide strip of land they called the Canal Zone. Panamanians were not included in the negotiations, and no Panamanian signed the treaty. The United States immediately placed the Canal Zone under military control.
Teddy Roosevelt was asked by what right he acquired possession of the canal. At least in the honest words of a thief, he said, "I took it." That gives you no right in law, never has. And hopefully, never will.
The canal project had a dramatic impact on Panama. The U.S. imported cheap labor from the Caribbean, India, and Asia, changing the racial makeup of the country. Thousands of these workers died, and those who remained lived as part of a new racial underclass.
They created an apartheid system in Panama, a system that was based on racial segregation, where black people could not live in the same homes, where black people could not even use the same water fountain. The Jim Crow law that was practiced in the southern part of the United States was implemented in Panama by the United States government.
after the canal was completed in 1913, the United States continued to expand its military presence and tighten its grip on Panamanian politics. Violent confrontations between Panamanians and the U.S. military grew in the decades that followed. Tensions peaked in 1964 when students tried to exercise Panama's right to fly its flag in the canal zone. 21 Panamanians were killed and hundreds were wounded in the confrontation. In 1968, Panama's government was overthrown in a military coup. Omar Torrijos, a colonel in the National Guard, emerged as the new leader of Panama. Although he used repressive measures to consolidate his power, he became immensely popular. Torrijos introduced an unexpected period of social reform that benefited Panama's majority population of blacks, Indians, and mestizos.
It created what some people call a populist reformist process.
Humberto Brown, an administrator at the State University of New York, served as a Panamanian diplomat to the United Nations. He was educated in Panama during the Torrijos period.
We're, for the first time in Panama, you had a participation of the non-oligarchical people of the nation, where people like myself get an opportunity to go to university, get a degree, where the peasants, where people from the mestizo, where all the people were deprived an opportunity for once in our life, were playing important roles in our nation.
In 1978, relations between the United States and Panama reached a high point. Jimmy Carter and Omar Torrijos negotiated treaties that abolished the 1903 treaty, establishing a new relationship between the two countries. The Carter-Torrijos treaties required the United States to vacate its military bases and withdraw its troops by the year 2000. Full control of the canal and the canal zone would be turned over to Panama. Although these new treaties were a source of pride for Panamanians, many conservatives in the United States had vehemently opposed them.
The Panama Canal Zone is sovereign United States territory.